Like to call the Iberia Parish Council, October 28, 2015, meeting to order. We all rise. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity and the freedom to be here tonight. Lord, we thank you for our families. We thank you for our health. We ask that you watch over us tonight and give us the strength and the wisdom to lead, to make good decisions on behalf of the people of Iberia Parish. Lord, we ask that you watch over our troops who protect the freedoms we enjoy here tonight. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Mr. Davis, would you lead us in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
Maggie Daniels. Dave Davis.
Here.
Tommy Landry. Marty Brown.
Here.
Mark Como.
Here.
Bernard Broussard.
Here.
Katie Hicks.
Here.
Ricky Gonsalves.
Here.
Lynn Romero.
Here.
Roger Duncan.
Here.
Jerome Tipp.
Here.
Ackland Reed Arnold.
Here.
Marty Trahan.
Here.
Wayne Romero.
Here.
Let the record reflect Ms. Daniels just walked in right after we called her name. Thank you for joining us, Ms. Daniels. We have a quorum. We'll get started. Approval of minutes, regular meeting, October 14th, 2015.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Broussard.
Second.
Second by Mr. Gonsalves. Discussion? Comments? Roll call. That motion carries. Persons to address the council, we have none. Reports, finance, and administrative action. There are none. Reports, parish and other governmental agencies. Item number one, reports by project engineers on various ongoing projects, including grant-funded projects, all in accordance with the resolution number 2013-49. Any comments? Item number two, Iberia Parish. Iberia Parish Sewer District. Number one, to provide a status update on the position of executive director. Do you want to report on that, on one of your projects at the airport, Mr. Gonsalves?
Yes, we're set up to give a presentation to the council on the different projects that we're in the process of and completing. And Ted Habbitt, the engineer for the airport, will accompany me with the presentation. I have the information to pass out. Thank you.
Sorry.
I'll be going to the laptop and we'll show the information.
All right. We're on item number one. Ladies and gentlemen, I jumped ahead and realized Mr. Gonsalves was filling this spot.
Construction and renovations took place at the airport, and each time we reported, we always reported on one single item. And over those past 4 years, we've had right about $17 million attributed to us from FAA, Department of Transportation of Louisiana, the council, which represents, which have the TIP dollars, and also some funds from our own budgets. But and Mr. Ted Habbitt with Barrett Habbitt and Associates has been our engineer for the past 4 or 5 years. Each year we looked at different engineering firms and we elected to have him again be our engineer for the past year. And we recognize his operation as very knowledgeable on the airport and all the construction that took place even from when the Navy left the airbase. And he will be pointing out some particular sites that we have some work on. What I'm going to cover right now is the dollars that were allocated and the dollars that were spent. I passed out a cash flow sheet, a spreadsheet to y'all that show all the different projects. And we have it on the screen so the public can also be aware of what dollars, their tax dollars that they have, where they have gone with y'all direction. This sheet, you won't read any numbers, but it's just to give an overall layout on this. The first section up here, where my cursor is, top left-hand corner shows 2012. Then it goes to 2013, 2014, 15, and 16. And it has the months. All the way to the left is the name of the project and the dollars and thousands that were contributed. The gray lines represent completed projects. The little squares with app in it means that's when the application was submitted. So some projects have gone up over 4 years. Some projects in excess of 4 years. But I'm going to go through each one of these, and then at a later, after we get through with this, Mr. Patterson is going to give us the particulars on another layout. Okay, on that seaway pump system, which was completed because it's in gray, we had $42K, $20K in runway markings, which took place in 2013. The 20-year master plan, which was being worked on prior to me being put on the commission for many years. It gets tweaked every 5 years, but that was finally submitted and approved by FAA. So the master plan is set now. Certification site that was done in 2012 and in 2013. That's a 65 acres that CLECO contributed dollars to run all the electrical. The sewer system has been put in along the road on that 65 acres, which is adjacent to the runway area. In a layout for a minute. Lemaire Airspace Study, $150,000. You can see the application was submitted in 2012. And we just finally got approval from the landowner so we can start cutting trees on the south end, which are getting too high for the approach. And so that project, removal of the trees is going to start within the next month, as soon as we get some bids, as soon as Mr. Havens gets the bids in from some contractors. But that's been a project that's been sitting out there for almost 4 years. At least 3 years. $492,000 was spent and almost complete. The ILS system, and that was some TIF dollars. That particular project, the only thing we're waiting for is a, what is the term, kid, for the plane to come in and do?
A flight check.
Flight check, yeah. FAA, we sent the dollars on the way to FAA. The state has released $47,000 on behalf so that FAA can contract a certain plane to come in and do the checking of the equipment that was put in. That's so construction's finished. You can see what I have it right here, pending flight. All the way to the right is pending flight check. Taxiway after joint seals, Mr. Havitz will show you where that project took place. That is one that's completed. Wildlife study, $92,000 there, $209,000, and $2,292,000 for the runway 1634, design and construction. Airfield lighting update and design, another 69K. Airfield lighting upgrade construction, $1 million, and we're in the process of completing that. Wind retrofit, Fireman Towers, thanks to Homeland Security. So I'd like to recognize our director there. Thanks for giving us the money so we could put some hurricane wind resistant windows on the tower, and also special windows and screens on a couple of buildings, the main office and the lower section of the tower. We built four box hangars, which have been, I think we have one that's pending lease, but the other three are leased. And then the ARFF model 1500 Striker fire truck, $723,000. We were donating, now these are actual dollars, that packed taxpayer dollars that we spent. There is another fire truck, as y'all recall, Lafayette donated a fire truck to us, and we have insurance on those at $675,000 piece. Plus they also gave to us, to the taxpayer, to the airport, a rapid response truck, and so we also have that particular vehicle. So that gives our standing for being able to respond with better equipment and more equipment. So we have $6,800,000 out.
Thank you.
That was just on grants. When I say taxpayer dollars, when I say grants, I mean it came from the federal government. About everybody pays taxes. So that's taxpayer dollars the way I look at all of this. Capital improvements and the other capital outlay grants, Two of them for Lemaire Airport, $600,000 on the first seven hangars that y'all authorized to be built. And y'all made us a loan for that particular project too. Another $629,000 on the other six. And the reason the cost was higher on the other six. I think there was a bid adjustment because we had to take care of some other work. But anyway, $1.2 million was spent at Lemaire Memorial Airport. TIF allocations. That's approved. Y'all allocated those funds, $1 million for the ARA terminal, which design has been completed, and we have authorized at yesterday's meeting for Mr. Alana to put his bid packages together, and he's setting the dates for the advertisement. Roof repair at Hangar 88, that's a project that y'all oversaw about 2 years ago, and we appreciate that. That was $231,000. The ATC tower radios, we have up-to-date radios in the tower. Frequency changes, the latest communications equipment has been installed in that tower. And they are very appreciative of that, so are the pilots. Perimeter fence project, this $90,000 was just to finish up a section, and Mr. Havis will show you where that took place. FAA saying that you need a security, sense of terrorist attack, FAA said you had to, I'm sorry, TSA said you had to see by securing the perimeter of the airport, which we did, and got approval on that. Hangar sewer connection 31, taxi lane connection almost a quarter of a million. Building 92 renovations. That's the building that's adjacent to the tower. That's the one that it right now is gutted, empty, but we had to replace the roof before we do any remediation on the inside because it had so much water. And thanks to the council for taking care of that, because now that may come into play with the Aviation School of Excellence if we can work that out. Taxiway rehabilitation is $1 million, and then $5 million with the 3212 access roads, which is not directly on airport property. But over the years, the council has seen that there was a lack of traffic flow to the airport. We missed out on a couple opportunities to get some big carriers in because of the delay in traffic and the way that is set up. So we appreciate that project getting started. Again, we're going to benefit, so with all the businesses around that area, even those that have big trucks trying to make some of those turns, that should straighten all that out. But we appreciate those dollars. That's going to put us in a better marketing position as time goes on. In-house projects. Now, the dollars aren't high for in-house projects because we don't get any millage, and we have to operate with our net revenues at the end of the year. Just fuel repairs and hangar doors, and also the roof repair on the export building. But whenever we had $229,000, that's the tower roof and improvements. That's when we started getting rain inside the control tower. We had just put in a little new radios and a lot of other equipment, and we saw there was a liability exposure on having some of those equipment short out on us when pilots were coming in. So that ended up being $229,000, and you can see in red we depleted the $183,000 the emergency account, which you guys created, ladies, whenever there was a settlement way back when. But those funds were used for that particular purpose, and we had to go back to some of our reserves and use to make up the difference to $229,000. Iberia Parish government marketing plan and lobbyist, $17,000 was allocated to work with so that Mike Tarantino and Jason DeValle and myself could work on, and Mr. Martin Trahal is on the group, and also Mr. Farcomo is in that meeting, in that committee. I'm trying to get something we can market the airport using high-tech media, flyers, DVDs, walkthrough videos, Mr. DeValle will give you all the report when he gets back from Fort Worth. The reason he's not here tonight is he went up to Fort Worth with a $30 million request to do some expansions on capital outlay on the FAA side. So hopefully he can come back with some good news. We hope that they can see that the growth that we're gonna show y'all is what he's showing them, and that they say, well, hey, it looks like y'all got it together, and we're going to support you guys. So we hope that, because right now, if we get some big carry in, or we get the noise waiver approved, we don't have a building to put them in. Payment classification number, that's a special certification on the runway. Mr. Habits will fill you in on that too when he gets to his particular function. Okay, so we have right, $16,849,000. These are dollars that were allocated. Some of it has been spent already. Some of it has been spent, but those projects are in the works. Or just one or two of them, I think, has not been started. But that's actual progress at the airport, and that we thank you for. There's just a few other projects that are pending that we don't have any funds for yet, but y'all may know some about some of these. The International School of Aviation Excellence, working through SLCC and One Acadiana. The FAR Part 31 noise waiver, where we got some reports back from our lobbyists. The FedEx SART facility, or UPS, whatever carrier we can get in there, we hope to have one in the future. And the new joint use fire district and URF fire station, that's additional dollars that he's asking for from FAA to also upgrade the airport. And hangar and service center. And like I said earlier, that if we have some big carrier come in and they want to come in here in 6 to 8 months, then we've got to try and scramble for a building. And so it's like, which one comes first? But if that does happen, then we have a little bit of a dilemma. So again, the bars just show the activity. The green, the colored bars are the ones where it's active. The gray bars are the ones where it's completed. So we appreciate, again, y'all giving those dollars. So now I'll turn it over to Mr. Ted. I'm going to call up another map. Y'all, let me pass this one out. This particular layout is going to show where every project took place at the airport. Because when you tell somebody we did this, they say, where y'all spent the money at? You know, or where did it, why y'all needed that? But if Mr. Value was here tonight, I can assure you, we're in the top 10% of airports in the United States as far as functionality and having some of the latest equipment. Now, some airports have a lot more sophisticated equipment, but we're not behind anymore. We have caught up and we can handle any aircraft, service company come in, or flight company, freight company to come in and handle. Hopefully, I hope one day we can see we're flying a lot of off-field equipment out of here already, but that remains to be seen, and we'd have to wait till that industry comes back up again. Okay, let me close this out, and Ted is going to give me some instructions now. First of all, I'm just going to show the taxpayers, because hopefully they can watch this on TV. But that's the piece of real estate that the taxpayers own. I think that is the largest single piece we have that parish owns. It's right under 2,000 acres, sits right here by Spanish Lake. It was much larger than that before the Navy shut it down. But that's what remains, and FAA is restricting us from selling any land. And as the council knows, we had to do a swap on a piece for the proper endpoint. That's a good chunk of land that sits right there. Nice piece of real estate. Highest real estate in Iberia Parish, and that's why the director of Homeland Security picked that spot. Okay. Okay, just going to talk overall on the sheet right now, then I'll zoom into certain sections. Let's turn that over to Ted. Ted?
Why don't you go ahead and zoom in on the ILS on the left-hand side, right-hand side of the board, right up in that area. He mentioned ILS. A lot of y'all probably, anytime you're dealing with the federal government, everything's always got three initials to it. ILS stands for Instrument Landing System. If you look at the runway, there's two long painted dashes that are on the line, and the perfect landing, if you're coming from the north to the south or from the south to the north, your plane's target is to land right over there. This instrument landing system right over here, this is the glide slope. A plane, big planes, like the ones that AVAX paints and things like it, 747, 777, 737s, they can come and land at this airport with 1/8 mile visibility when the ILS system is in operation. Right now, we have a brand new ILS system. This right over here, when the plane's coming from over out of the south, over the Port of Iberia, and they're flying in, when they're about 2 miles out, they're starting their descent coming in. That is the glide slope. That's telling them you're too high, you're too low, you're too high, you're too low. Another part of that ILS system is out over here. There's a building that's off on the side, and back up a little bit the other way, you're off right there. There's a radar that's right here at the end. That's a DME, the distance measuring equipment. That's telling the plane how far he is coming away from the airport. He follows that in, his wheels are going to touch down on those two dashes that I told you all about a little while ago. Also, FedEx planes and things like that are coming in the fog, they have infrared equipment so they can see the lights at the side of the runway. So They're wear out over there. They can see the lights on the airport, they can know what slope they're supposed to be coming in, and they know how far they have to come in. 1/8 of a mile visibility. If it flies, it can land on that airport. When you're looking at that drawing and you see how we have a red line outlining the airport runway and the taxiway, we just got finished joint sealing all of the joint seals on the taxiway itself to protect that part of the runway. And we're waiting on the notice to proceed from the FAA. We already bid the job, we have the money, but we're waiting on a notice to proceed from the FAA to joint seal all of the joints on this runway to protect the runway itself. If you can keep the moisture from getting down below the runway, we'll protect that forever. We're gonna have about 45 miles of joints to seal in that runway. This thing's 200 foot wide. Every piece of concrete over there is 12 and a half foot wide, 15 foot long. There's no rebar in most of this. It's just, it's so big and so thick that the planes can land on it. Another part of that project that we're working on right now, we're actually gonna be grooving the runway. That's for the big planes. That's to improve their braking. Once we groove all the runway, we'll be messing up all the paint markings, so we're gonna remark that runway again. And that's all federal money. State money right now that we're waiting to get the authorization to spend. We relamping the entire runway. All the lights are going to be put in, and all the signs are going to be LED. All the lights along the runway, they'll still be incandescent or quartz, because an LED light doesn't emit infrared. And when those planes are coming in the fog, they have to be able to see infrared with their pieces of equipment. So all the lights along the runway are going to stay incandescent or quartz. But we replaced the lights about 25 years ago. We relamped the entire runway. Here, we're going through that whole system again. You're looking at about $4 million that we're spending just on the runway from 1 year ago to 1 year ahead. Let's go up in this area there, Randy. N number also. That's something that the FAA gave us some money to spend. It took us about $90,000. We had to go about every 200 feet all the way down the runway, the taxiway, and the apron. We did saw borings, took samples below the concrete, tested the cylinders, and what we came up with was a number. That number is 39. That doesn't mean anything to y'all, perhaps, but to an airplane when he's coming in, every airplane has what's called an aircraft number, and every runway is going to have what's called a PCN. It's a pavement number. As long as the airplane's number is equal to or less than your airport number, the plane can come land there. So you might have a huge, gigantic plane, he's full of fuel, and he's totally overweight, we can't accept him. But the pilot already knows that. Now, we can exceed that by 10% of the landings and the operations per year. So in the past, we've had to hand calculate if we're gonna allow. We've had military aircraft, they're gonna load that thing up with people and equipment, they load up with fuel, they take off from over here, and it'll be the 2-week exercise that the National Guard's going all the way to Korea to do. Now we have that number that's been pre-calculated.
Before, with the AVAX planes coming in, some of them couldn't come in with a lot of fuel. And it was questionable as to whether we were really at that 39. Now they took all these core samples, we had that, and so now they can key into the computers and know exactly what the roll speed of that plane can be when it lands from the impact. Taking off, you can have a little bit more fuel because it's not an impact situation. But that really meant a lot to AVAX, because now they can come in with a little bit more fuel with those big planes that they're painting. And it's really, and those planes, and the number of wheels is the other thing that really comes into play. They got some planes that are maybe a little bit smaller, but the weight per square inch, it may exceed 39 because they only have 4 tires on each wing versus 6 or 8. So a lot goes into those calculations, and a PCN number is really critical at an airport, so we have a good number.
Randy, you said it was a little bit more fuel. You meant 30,000 pounds more fuel we can put in those planes out. So it's a sizable amount of fuel, so that when the planes are finished being painted, they don't have to leave here and go, like land in Boeing, to tank up again to go make a flight over to China. If it's one of the Chinese planes, they can actually fuel up over here and make the flight all the way out.
And we do have some foreign planes coming in, beautiful planes.
A lot of the calculations we did, like you said, it was based on numbers. Y'all might have seen in the news where they had a Russian plane that loaded up that took off. He had so many wheels under the bottom, he looked like a caterpillar. You could have landed him on dirt compared to the American planes that run about 325 pounds of pressure in the tires. It's very hard on the concrete, so that's why we had to do the calculation. The next area I'd like to talk about is what we call the general aviation. This is a lot of TIF money that we're spending in this particular area right here. This was the 1940 series runway and airport that was originally there before the Navy base came in the late 50s, early 60s. They cut into the runway and put the taxiway Alpha that's over here. Carborundum went ahead and built over there out on the outside of the airport property on the actual runway. Right now, we're joint sealing all of this. This has not been done since the 1940 series runway was actually installed. We've connected the runway from here over to this area where we have a whole line over here before the plane goes on to the taxiway Alpha. They go ahead and get permission from the tower to go to access the main runway. We just got finished pouring this one right over here. All of this concrete got destroyed when we had the ag facility. Cattle export facility. They were loading cattle into 727s. 727s run tremendous amount of pressure in the tires. They don't have very many tires, and they're loading those planes full of cattle. All of this concrete in this particular area, it's only 5.5 inches thick. That was made for those little 1940 planes that were tail draggers. So a lot of this concrete got crushed. This is still in very good shape. So this is very, very, very excellent when we're going to be finished. We actually built four hangars over here. Here's a three-pack that's put together. This is a little bit larger hangar that you can actually put a jet in. We're going to be finishing all of this here. That's about $1 million worth of money. We've replaced the drainage structure. We added that taxi lane connector. We're adding that taxi lane connector. And way out off to get on that side of the drawing. In this area, we got some more concrete that we're fixing. There's an automatic gate over here next to this Bristow hangar.
And mosquito control, point out where mosquito control is.
That's mosquito control. They're located inside of our perimeter fence of the airport also. Let's move a little bit further to the left. In this particular area. Let's talk about this, the P1 area. We spent about $30,000. That's not that much compared to the $16 million of the entire airport. But suppose somebody wanted to come over there and they were interested in looking at constructing anything over here in the airport. We have the soil borings for this. We know how much gas is available, how much electricity is available. We know the rail that's available to them, what's the access. All of the environmental work has already been done on this piece of property. When we said it's a certified site, it's certified. Somebody wants it. If there's cane planted on, we know how much it costs. To give the people the information, it costs you this much to get the cane off the property that we owe the farmer. That is a certified site. So anybody that's interested in this 65 acres, or we can split it in half because we have a little ditch that runs across. If they want the whole site, we even know how much it's going to cost to fill the ditch. If there's a piece of information they need, we've already have that information for them. Over here in the blue area, that was a wildlife study the FAA paid for. The reason we have that circled over there is that's where we went ahead and knocked down the trees. That was noticed that there was a lot of roosting that was going on in here. But when they had the wildlife study, it was a whole year study that took place. It went through the four seasons, and not just on the airport. They went 5 miles around the airport. The cane, we had a landfill facility. They monitored that. Spanish Lake, what was happening with the ducks over there, and the ducks that were flying from Spanish Lake to the Seaway, and it was a $90,000 expense. But that was what they highlighted mostly was the trees that we had around the airport, where we had big birds, raptors that were eating the small rats and stuff like that. So we went ahead and got rid of the trees around the airport, and consequently, we don't have as many of the big raptors around the airport. Another item you see on there, it says perimeter fence. We say fence completed. 2002, 2005, 2007, 2009. Each one of those years, we did $300,000 worth of work. That's about $1.2 million worth of fence work, and we had a drainage structure that we had to do a little bit type of construction right over there, and we had a drainage structure right over here. We had to do a little bit different type of construction. So when we say perimeter fence completed, we spent $1.2 million to build a fence, and it only took us $90,000 more to complete that. But then we told the FAA we have a complete security fence around the airport now, and we have about 5 controlled access points to the airport. Go ahead and move a little bit further over. We had part of that 88 roof. There was actually a contract that was bid in 2001, and they were interested in doing the work in 2001, and that's when 9/11 hit, and the work did not get installed to replace the roof on the about half of Hangar 88. But 2 years ago, y'all actually came up with the money to help us replace that roof on Hangar 88. Thank you. The fire station that he was talking about, we've got a $800,000 brand new fire rescue truck. Got a fire or something, the camera can look in there and they can see through the smoke to see if there's any people, if they have an aircraft accident. Up on there also, we say we have the Lafayette fire rescue truck. Lafayette got a new one, and their truck, they allowed us to have it. They donated it to us with the agreement that if they need it and there's an accident over there, that we're going to go over there and help them with the truck. We'll probably go over there with the new one. But we got two nice fire trucks that are sitting over there in our fire rescue station. And we got some new bay doors, which are hardened. All of that got in installed. On the ARA, there's a whole new wind retrofit to harden that area, too. We got a new roof, thanks again to Homeland Security. Prior to that, we actually had 3 generators that were installed. One services emergency power to all of our jet fuel. When they got a hurricane or something and they got the Coast Guard and everybody else that's coming on, we got an emergency generator so we can pump all the fuel. We got a generator facility that goes to the ARA office, as well as connections so we can put state police, whoever needs to be over there on the site. We got a whole area where we can plug them in. And we have another generator that got installed on the air traffic control tower. So we're really set up for that type of operation. When you're looking at Building 92, we had a new roof that got installed on Building 92. Building 92 is the building that's around the control tower. We actually have that separated for security reasons. But on the control tower itself, at the very top of the tower, top where all the antennas are, we got a new roof that we just put on that. We hardened all the windows around there. It's called large missile resistant. That's not a missile is what you would consider, but a large missile, they consider an 8-foot 2x4 flying at you at a certain speed due to a hurricane. And those windows won't let that penetrate, so you can have the people in there, hopefully not during the storm, but they're large missile resistant. New aircraft radios and the wind retrofit there also. Hardened all the windows and everything all around that that control tower, so we got good access there. I think that's about it, Randy. Oh, that little bitty dot, where was I at? I skipped one. New terminal right over there. That's more TIF money. It's not just a terminal, it's gonna be a little multi-purpose facility that's actually gonna be attached on to the ARA office. And part of what Jason is doing right now, when they're over there at the FAA, we're looking to build a new fire station at a more centralized location. When the tower calls, that truck needs to be anywhere on that airport in case we have an accident within 2 minutes ready to fight the fire. So we're trying to relocate the fire trucks from the end over here to somewhere more centralized and share that with the Coteau area to have them available for that. When that becomes available, this whole the bays where we have all of the fire trucks in there, that's going to be converted to multi-purpose use also. Thank you. Any other comments there, Randy?
Any questions?
Thank you very much for all your work to put together this presentation. It was very informative. I think our airport is on the map. Item number 2, Iberia Parish Sewers District, number 1, to provide a status update on the position of an executive director.
Before we get into the actual position of the executive director, I thought it might help if we talk a little bit about how the district was formed and what revised statutes we operate under. Probably most people haven't really thought about that. But basically, the district was formed around 1975, and it was formed under revised state statute 33381, which is a state statute. And a little bit more about the sewer district. There were actually four districts that were originally formed in Iberia Parish. At some later date, and I'm not sure exactly when that was, three of them were disbanded, and that was all rolled over into one district, which is District 1. District 1 covers the Iberia Parish, except for the incorporated areas, and also excludes the Atchafalaya Basin. So everything else in the parish is part of District 1. It's one of the largest in the areas, if not the state. A lot of our surrounding parishes have sewer districts that maybe cover one subdivision or a little part. I think St. Mary Parish has like 13 sewer districts that each operate independently from each other. Districts that are created under revised statute 33381 are actually a political subdivision of the state, much as a lot of other ports and airports and what have you. As a political corporation, the district can incur debt, issue bonds, and perform any and all acts necessary to carry out the objects and purpose of the creation. A sewer district, through its governing authority, which is the Board of Supervisors, which y'all appoint, sets its rates for service and must cover its operating costs each year. Talk a little bit about what the Board of Supervisors, by state mandate, by state statute, are required to do. The board is required to be the governing authority of the district. It appoints the executive director. It elects its own chairman and vice chairman from its members. It, of course, you monitor and critique the performance of the executive director, and you approve the budget. That's the state requirements for the board of directors. That statute also has certain duties that y'all, as the parish government, have to are responsible for. And that's to create the district, which y'all did, this board did in 1975. You set the boundaries for the board, for the district, which was originally done. There were four set up, three were disbanded. Y'all elected to allow the district to expand to cover those other three districts. One of those districts is the port of Iberia, by the way. Y'all appoint the board of directors, and y'all are required to appoint at least three, no more than five. And y'all have the authority to disband this board, the sewer district, at any time y'all so desire. And that's y'all responsibility. That's not the board's responsibility. So that's kind of, I just wanted to give a little background on what state statute 33381 talks about. And I'm sure there's a lot of legalese in it that I don't know. If somebody has a real legal issue, we have Mr. Lopresto here, who's kind of lived with the board and its creation and how we've evolved over the years. With that in mind, if y'all have any questions or any particular questions y'all would like to ask, feel free to. I will try to answer.
Any questions on what he's presented so far? Continue.
Okay. We had Mr. Gonzalez had been the executive director for years and years. Just as any other public employee has under the parish council, he had some accumulated sick leave and what have you that when he became ill, he elected to take it. That would have probably run out sometimes around December or early January. At that time, he would have to make a decision, if he was still around, on what he was going to do. Knowing that the job description that was in place for that position didn't really meet the actual function of the executive director and what he was doing. We started working on a revision to that executive director position, a job description. That was finalized two months ago. And at that time, we started looking at when were we going to implement a search for a new director. In the meantime, Mr. Gonzalez passed away, and we started the process. We are now advertising for that position that we as a Board of Supervisors are required to appoint someone in that position. We have started the search. Hopefully, towards the end of November, we will have applications that we can review and move forward with the position in some capacity. But we are required to fill the position.
Anything else?
Anything else?
Any questions?
That's all I have.
Okay. Any questions?
Just thank you. Thank you for your service. Appreciate it very much.
Okay.
I do have one comment. You guys have done an amazing job holding things together through all these troubled times with Mr. Gonzalez's illness. I can only speak for me personally. I have not given up on the thought of creating a utilities superintendent or a supervisor for the parish. And I would hope that you guys would postpone your decision and entertain that conversation, how to make this work with the new administration after the first of the year. Because truly, when you sit in this seat, on this side of the table, we need, in my opinion, we need someone to help manage and organize the entire parish as it pertains to utilities and several other job description or duties that are not being fulfilled now. I just think it would be unfair to hire someone and then the new administration come in and make a move to make those changes in our boards and commissions and have someone not see the whole picture and come in and not have a job in 6 or 8 months from now if the administration chooses to go in that direction and this council or the next council decides to make those changes, whatever they might be or need to be, to make that happen. So.
And we don't know what y'all are planning to do. So, I mean, all we know is what we need from our end of it. And so that's kind of the way we've been moving, but it won't take place immediately.
Right.
So if there is some, you know, if the new administration wants to look at something else, we need to get together pretty quickly and try to figure out where we're going with this thing.
Well, I would, just me personally, I would advise someone, you guys decide on if you or someone else needs to get with the new administration as soon as possible and see if they have any position on that and what their thoughts are and give them some time to wrap their arms around that topic. And just not to take two steps forward and six backwards and, you know.
Well, and the other thing is that this is a full-time position. We're talking about just to handle the district's operation.
Correct.
So, I mean, you know, I don't know how much time anybody's thinking about that particular utility director, if it is created, what his job description is going to be.
Correct.
Because he will have to actually spend, if he does run both, he's going to have to spend a lot of time with the district.
Correct.
Just taking care of day-to-day operations and.
Right, and that's the whole purpose of why I'm reaching out to you now, because we can't even speculate what it's going to look like because the discussion hasn't even started yet.
Yeah.
There could be another person with a different name or title. There's a thousand different ways it could develop if the right people sit together and want to make it work. I think it can happen with reasonable efforts.
And
we come out better and more efficient when we finish.
And we're not committed to anything. It's just we know that we as a board have to
That's your obligation.
Due diligence and have obligations
right.
to replace that person.
Right.
In some capacity. So we know we have to move forward. That's part of the state statute, that we have to do something.
Correct. And I appreciate you guys fulfilling your responsibility. But I don't, you know, I just don't want you to lose sight that this is a possibility. And then you say, Troy, why didn't you tell me that? I wish I would have known.
We knew there was some talk about it.
Right.
But, you know,
right.
We don't know which direction the council or the new parish president, the administration, is going to go with this thing.
Correct. And that's why I just said it needs to, the conversation needs to be had to see if that's going to, if who's going to, if someone's going to, in the new administration, the new council, is going to pursue that. In my opinion, it needs to be done, but I won't be here. So, well wishes to those who will. Ms. Daniels?
Even though Mr. Gonzalez is no longer with us, has the board selected someone as an interim in his place until?
We have had someone acting as interim for a number of months now. So we have someone in place, but we just know that it's an interim position, and we have to fill the position eventually.
Okay, and one more question. The job description that y'all basically have, I'm not even going to go there, but y'all looking for a new director. Have y'all even offered that position to the interim?
We have not. We have basically followed parish council's guidelines on filling those kind of positions. We're advertising. Anyone can apply for the position. Sometimes in probably December or early January, we'll sit down and look at the applicants, whoever they may be, and go and move forward based on that.
Okay, that wasn't my question, but that's okay.
Well, we have okay. Not just offered it to a person at this time.
So the interim, the person who's serving as interim director
has the right to apply, just like anyone else in the parish or right. anywhere outside the parish right. has the right to do it.
It's you just can't offer it to that person only.
Right.
You have to advertise for them.
I think it's good policy to at least open it up to anybody that might wish to apply.
No. Okay. You good? Anyone else? Thank you, sir. Thank you all for being here. Item number 3, compensatory time report for the quarter of July, August, and September 2015, all in accordance with resolution numbers 2013-441 and 2014-33. Any comments? I'd just like to reserve the option to come back and make comments. I didn't get the package till late last night when I got home from another meeting, so I didn't have a chance to review that like I would have hoped. So, no, yes, you don't mind. Maybe we could just put it as
for discussion
if anyone has any. Cause it's not a simple issue to just needs to be. Reviewed, I should say. Any other comments? Public Works reports. Public Works Department report for closed work orders dated October 5th through 9th and 12th through 16th, 2015. Any comments, questions? Special business, we have none. Excuse me, I apologize. So. Council member announcements?
Yes, I have one.
Mr. Trahan? Welcome back, Mr. Trahan. We're glad
Thank
you're feeling
you.
Better.
I'm glad to be back in full body and mind. As of 6:20 this afternoon, Sean Meats signed the papers with the SBA and the bank. They will build a grocery store in Delcom.
Wow.
As of this afternoon at 6:20.
That's been a long haul.
Yes, and he's went through some hoops to get there.
Yeah.
And
awesome.
Just to the people of Delcom, y'all got a grocery store coming. Thank you
Fantastic.
All. Thank you all for the past council that appropriated this money. Jerome, Bernard, Maggie, and all of y'all, Lloyd, thank you all. We appreciate it.
Mr. Fitch?
Mr. Chairman, I hope you give me a couple of minutes to say a few things that I think I need to say. And when I came to the meeting tonight, I stopped at Brenda's office and talked to her, and I felt compelled to say what I have to say, and I hope I can articulate my thoughts without stepping on my tongue, and if I do so, I'm sorry, but...
Take your time, Mr. Fitch.
I'm gonna try. First of all, I want to thank all of you guys that I served with. I mean, it's been my pleasure. And I can honestly say that I can leave here happy and without any ill thoughts, no regrets, and with all of y'all still my friends, and I really appreciate that very much. And those of you who are not coming back, you can hold your heads up high, because we leaving this parish in good shape. And although I have my concerns, I have no regrets about the future parish council. I offer my help to the guy who replaced me, Brian. Brian, if you need any help, I'd be more than happy to help you, and I promise you I'll do whatever I can for you. I'm compelled to say a few things. You know, after reading the paper again today, and I get kind of upset about people complaining about this council. Dysfunction was a big word. Just want you all to know that this is the same council that had a master plan 10 years ago that completed the majority of that master plan, and I'm very proud of that. We probably accomplished more than the previous councils ever have done in that 10-year plan. If you go back, if I can urge any new elected officials to do anything, go back and read that report and see what we've accomplished. And I challenge you to try and accomplish what we did in the next 10-year plan. It's there for you to look at, and I want to thank Mr. Como, Mr. Broussard, Mr. Landry. We were all part of that committee to set that 10-year plan in place. And I think it's a good goal to try to achieve, and hopefully y'all can work toward that in unison and get this parish moving forward again. I'm excited about the future, although I'm concerned. I think y'all can do a good job and learn from all mistakes. I also want to say this, that, you know, I know we blamed, we called dysfunctional, and a number of other comments that really sometimes upset me, and I know I shouldn't upset me, and I just let it roll off my back. You're an elected official, you got to take a lot of heat. But I can say we tried, and I know a number of us tried. It's like, and I don't know a good analogy to use, but to be simple, I guess you could say it's like going rabbit hunting without a lead dog. I mean, we were beating the bras, beating the bushes, doing everything, and we basically got no help. And I can tell you that we tried. I personally tried. Mr. Romero said he needed some help, and I believe Mr. Romero to be a good man, but I think he had some bad advice. I wish him well. I went in his office when he said he needed some help to offer him help, and I mean, he stuck his finger in my face and just told me to basically, he didn't need me, didn't want me. It happened more than once. So I just gave up after that. It's no use fighting. But it wasn't this council's fault, and you guys are not reelected. Hold your heads up high. You have nothing to be ashamed of. You did a great job. And I appreciate the time I served with y'all. Thank y'all very much.
Thank you, Mr. Fitch. So the open door policy that was spoke about so many times was not really.
Well, I think you can ask Mr. Duncan about that. He could probably share some light on it also.
You ready to go, Mr. Duncan?
No, I'll save it for the next meeting.
All right. I'll look forward to that. Anyone else? Okay, parish president announcements. Anyone from the administration? Public comments on ordinances and resolutions. Moved by Mr. Broussard, second by Ms. Daniels to go into public hearing. Roll call. That motion carries. We're now in public session. Anyone have any comments on any item on the agenda? Please join us at the podium and state your name for the record and the item you'd like to speak to. This is your time to speak. Anyone in the public have anything to say about any item on the agenda tonight? Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Jason Akers, LaFolia Udell. As is customary, I'd like to reserve comment on summary number 332, and that item comes up on the agenda, please. But there is an ordinance being introduced, is summary number 4703, that also deals with the hospital service district. I want to be clear that this is a separate ordinance, and I know we don't normally talk about introduced ordinance, but I do want to be clear, because it will be almost a month before it comes up for adoption, that this is a separate ordinance than the $6 million bond sale that took place in September and that actually closed yesterday. This is a separate bond sale in accordance with a separate project, and you probably have a good idea of what that is.
Mr. Broussard?
What did the $6 million close at? What rate?
$6 million was closed a 20-year transaction for a fixed rate for 10 years of 2.75%.
Thank you.
Randy Gosselin, 408 Estee Drive. I'd like to talk in summary 308. We had a couple of councilmen that were not here at the last meeting, so I'm going to restate my statement on concerning the appointment of the Iberia Parish Airport Commissioner. This appointment will be filling the oncoming vacancy that will be created by Mrs. Wendy Eldridge on October 28th, which is today. Today is the last day. Mrs. Eldridge was literally our eyes at the airport, and that as a supervisor of the control tower, she had viewed and had firsthand knowledge of air and ground traffic of all types of aircraft and was made aware of what issues that cropped up on taxiways and ramps and obstructions that needed to be addressed for the benefit of all pilots flying fixed wing, float plane, and rotorcraft, whether it was private, corporate, or military aircraft entering ARH airspace. She brought to the commission a unique perspective of what actually went on at the Acadiana Regional Airport, which will be very, very hard to match. However, it has come to the point where a replacement has to be chosen from those that have agreed to volunteer their time and share their expertise in overseeing the management of two airports owned by Iberia Parish taxpayers through its director, Mr. Jason DeValue, which are more commonly known as Lemaire Memorial Airport in Generette and Acadiana Regional Airport in New Iberia. Combined, both airports occupy in excess of 2,000 acres of land and consist of 38 tenants with approximately 50 aircraft, fixed wing and rotorcraft, housed in hangar facilities providing in excess of $1.4 million in rental income, making ARA self-sustaining, as well as generating approximately $1.2 million in property tax that is paid directly to the Iberia Parish government by its tenants. That being said, the responsibility of making the right decision as a whole and maintaining a professional relationship where proper respect is maintained between commissioners is paramount. On Tuesday, October 13, 2015, at a regular meeting of the Iberia Parish Airport Authority, and at my request, three of the five applicants addressed the authority and were asked what each of them could bring to the table to assist and improve the outlook on such an asset, again owned by the taxpayers. Mr. David Lamb informed us of his legal background and his desire to get involved. Mr. Jared Landry expressed his interest in becoming part of IPAA with new ideas and his indirect association with AVEX. Mr. Gerald Falk offered his assistance through the association with One Acadiana, who is presently working with SLCC in possibly setting up an aviation center of excellence at ARA, and his association with IDF, as well as contacts through all of the past associations and organizations that he was part of. Mr. Carl Vincent had other obligations and was not able to attend. Mr. Tom LeBlanc was out of the country, but having prior engineering experience, a pilot and part owner of Service 2 Company, with direct contacts to FedEx and other freight handlers, he has an opportunity to possibly provide an added benefit in the way of marketing and recruiting strategies related to freight haulers, especially if FAA grants a noise waiver for foreign aircraft having direct flights into the U.S. via Acadiana Regional Airport. Upon the adjournment of the meeting, I polled the officers and commissions present and asked a simple question. If you were a stockholder or board of director of a similar entity that we presently served on, which two applicants would you call back for a second interview to become part of a management team? Of the 10 opinions provided, the responses were as follows. Mr. Tom LeBlanc, 4. Mr. Gerald Falk, 4. Mr. Jared Landry, 2. Having said that, I'm requesting the Iberia Parish Council, the entity that appointed each of the present commissioners, to consider the info presented and select one of the two individuals noted above having the highest ranking to fill the oncoming vacancy and serve alongside the team that U.S. members of the council have appointed over the past years based on the added benefit that we, the present commissioners, have brought to the table. However, due to the tabling of this resolution at the last council meeting and the outcome of the election, and based on Mr. Troy Como's belief that there was an arterial motive to table, I ask that the decision to appoint a new commissioner to the Iberia Parish Airport Authority be tabled once again and deferred for 2 months to January 2016, 65 days from now, and the decision be granted to the new council, whom the majority of voters elected last Saturday. In closing, ladies and gentlemen, and speaking as a taxpayer, a new league has been created by the majority of voters, and the majority of voters were in charge of drafting the new players. That being said, I ask this council to give the incoming new council members an opportunity to represent their constituents and their wants by deferring all matters that can be deferred, including this appointment, to January of next year, and let the new legislature, the incoming council members, team up with the new executive, the incoming parish president, in doing what I believe the majority of voters want. Unity within our parish government and effective management and accountability of taxpayers' dollars. Again, please defer at least this resolution to the new council in January. Thank you for your attention.
Any questions?
Yes,
Mr. Duncan?
So, Mr. Randy Gonsalves, so you're saying this council just needs to go home and shut up, right? Is that what you're saying?
That's not what I said.
I was elected 4 years ago to serve this council, serve this parish, and I'm going to serve this parish tonight. I am not voting for no table. We tabled it last time. We're going to vote on it tonight. So you're telling me to take the rest of the other three guys that you had voted on and throw them out? They ain't no good. That's what you're saying.
That's not what I'm saying.
That's exactly what you said. You said to vote on the two people that you picked.
Nope.
So it's until January 6th, I am appointed to serve this council and serve this parish, and that's what I'm going to do
tonight.
I ask
that you'll consider it. Thank you, sir.
Anyone else?
I'd like to speak, David Moore, speaking on resolution number 329 regarding the Rinell Estates subdivision phase two. I'd like to just give a little brief summary history of this item, just so that y'all know what's going on with that. We had contacted by the owner of the property located on McAnally Road to prepare the plats to subdivide that piece of property into five lots, which basically extends the subdivision that we had created on the adjacent property in 2007. There's about nine lots on the existing piece on the phase one, and this was the remaining piece of property that he owns there in that area, and so we wanted to create the additional five lots there. We applied for the development through the Planning Commission on April 1st to try to get it on the on that agenda there. For a couple of different reasons, it was put off until the June planning meeting. I think there was 1 month that didn't have a quorum, another month it was tabled for another reason. I'm not sure, don't remember what that was. So in June came up, there was some discussions about the development. Some of the neighbors came in and requested to speak against the development. The items that were discussed there against the development were one regarding the flood issues for the property. And it's explained at that time that this property is in a V-zone. It is in a flood zone according to the FEMA flood maps, and that's duly noted on the plats that we have submitted. So that anybody that buys these lots would have to conform to the FEMA regulations and also obviously the parish building code regulations, which also mandate that they construct it according to the FEMA flood regulations. The other thing that was discussed about was whether they would be allowed to put trailers on these lots. The lots are 100 feet wide. I forget exactly how deep they are, 300 feet deep or something like that. So it was discussed about whether the trailers would be allowed on that. Again, it was discussed that this property did not need to be rezoned. It's actually zoned agricultural now, which allows for trailers to be built on those properties. It also allows for regular stick-built homes or modular homes or any type of home there. And so that was discussed that we were not asking for any type of rezoning. We're asking strictly to subdivide the property. I think there was a commission member had asked if we would restrict it to restrict the trailers out of the subdivision, in which case they would approve the subdivision, and I told them that I could not speak to for the owner at that point, but that since the existing phase one allowed trailers, that probably that they would want the phase two to allow the trailers also. So at that meeting, the Planning Commission voted to deny the subdivision based on those two reasons, that there was flood issues with FEMA and that there was going to be trailers allowed on that. So at that point, it was denied. And also at that point, we thought that it was going to be coming to the Parish Council for review and for a final either approval or ratification of that denial, or whether that would be overturned. In our experience in the past, that's always been the case. It's always been the policy, is that the votes of the Planning Commission were votes for recommendation to this board, and that the Parish Council had the final say on all these matters, whether it was to approve or deny. For a lot of different reasons, it was not brought before the Parish Council for a few months. And we had several discussions with Mr. Raines' office. Mr. Shealy had some discussions in there trying to decide, trying to figure out what's going on, why could we not get heard to ask for approval of this subdivision. And it's finally now before you tonight. In the meantime, Mr. Raines put it back onto the Planning Commission and explained to them at that time, that happened early this month, that the two reasons that were given for denial of the subdivision were not valid reasons according to the Parish subdivision ordinances. There was some more discussions about the property and about different things going on there, and at that time the Planning Commission voted, and you know, John can talk about that as well. I don't want to speak out of turn, but the Planning Commission did vote to deny based on the that it would have a negative impact on the parish-owned property across the street, which is Rinella Park, and to the neighboring properties also, that it would have a negative impact to that. So tonight the item on the agenda comes to you with a recommendation from the Planning Commission of denial, and I'm here asking for the developer that y'all would consider that and take a look at this. And we feel that the even the most recent vote by the Planning Commission is not an adequate or not a recognized reason for denying this subdivision. We feel like that we have provided a subdivision that is in accordance, full accordance with the Iber Parish ordinance. And we are not asking for any waivers. We're not asking for anything different from that. And so we ask for your approval tonight for this item.
Any questions from Mr. Moore?
Yes, Mr. Cummel.
Mr. Duncan.
Mr. Raines, was those two reasons the only two reasons they gave? Was there any evaluation of homes or the evaluations of our park, Rinella Park, that was implemented into the denial?
No. Hold on, Mr. Raines. Would you mind if we wait until we go into the regular session, if you don't mind?
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Duncan.
Any other questions?
No. If we have questions for you, I'll recognize you to answer those questions, Mr. Moore, in that discussion. Mr. Ditch?
I recognize a couple of the homeowners that might have, they were here at their other meeting. If they want to speak, now's their time.
My name is Dennis Babineau, 816 David Dubon Road. We are speaking against the proposed subdivision. This subdivision is under the guidelines of the Planning and Zoning Commission, which took effect in 2009. This phase one, which happened before 2009, was unrestricted. Anything was put there, and there's nothing, or maybe I'm talking too soon about, well, anyway, there's no restrictions. They were asking for an R2 classification from A1, I think, which is agriculture, to an R2. And it was brought to our attention, if it is subdivided and R2, the property owner could, at one time, come back, ask for a variance for an R4, which could have two structures on each property. We feel it's going to devalue all the people who've built homes in this area, devalue the Ronella Ballpark, and we are asking the Parish Council to honor the Planning and Zoning Commission, which has denied it twice on an 8-1 vote and a 6-0 vote. Thank you.
Any questions for Mr. Babineau? Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Babineau. Thank you for being part of the process. State your name for the record, please.
My name is Joy Babineau, and I live at 816 David Dubon Road, which is catacorner to these lots proposed. In addition to what my husband just said, it's not just the flood zone, it's the total safety of these mobile homes or whatever homes that may be established here with no zoning. When my husband said 2006 is when phase one came about, and there were no restrictions, so anything could be put there. Mr. Raines at one time had asked why we didn't object then. Well, there were no zoning, you know, ordinances, so we had no right or whatever. In 2009, I think it was, the zoning came into effect, and I have to believe, you know, just for the safety of these residents and ourselves or whatever. I don't know if many of you remember. If I may, I'd like to pass some pictures around of phase one. Is that permitted?
Yes, ma'am. You can hand them to Ms. Daniels. She'll forward them through.
And we also, again, respectfully ask that you abide by the Planning Committee's request, or their vote, two times. And I also have these pictures I'd like for you to look closely at. And it's not just the flooding element. This picture in particular shows my son, my oldest son, who lived in our backyard. His mobile home, this was for Hurricane Gustav, which is right before Hurricane Ike. So it's not just the flooding element, but the roof on his mobile home was completely peeled back by winds of the hurricane. I can't imagine that this council or, you know, would allow these people to come and settle with the likelihood of these disasters being horrible for them. We have lived through them twice. We have now elevated our home, and I can tell you it is not a pleasant situation to go to, although I know that it should not be based on emotional, you know, concerns. I just respectfully ask that you honor the Planning Committee's vote to deny. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Any questions for Ms. Bowden?
Yes. What are these pictures?
Those pictures, sir, are phase one of Rhinella Estates. Now, and I do have one question, okay? Bings, phase one was implemented before 206, and there was no zoning ordinances, okay? Then in 2009, the zoning ordinances became effective. Does that grandfather Mr. Vermilion Holdings in, or Bings, those new ordinances in that place was not developed at the time, does he have to abide with the new zoning ordinances?
Mr. Raines, can you answer that question for Ms. Babineau?
Any approvals that Vermilion Holdings might have had at the time of the Planning Commission or at the time of the creation of the zoning ordinance would have been honored. If they had been duly processed and approved by the commission and the council, and it was a final plat or a final approval, I would automatically assume, and I would assume the council as well, would honor those approvals. Anything that would happen after that time that would not be in compliance with the previous approvals might be a different matter.
And we, I'll refrain to, okay. Hold on. Go ahead, Ms. Davenport.
Okay, let me just, say that. I think it was like about in June or July, maybe one of the meetings, and I think it was Mr. Fitch, we had come before the parish council, the whole council, and I think it was Mr. Fitch who had asked for a legal, binding decision on that, and we never, got that answer. I had asked Mr. Shealy in the hall one time, and he said no, he hadn't gotten to it yet. And here we are another 2 months later. Looks like he still hasn't gotten to it. So I just please abide by the permit committee's decision. Thank you.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Davis? You have a question for Ms. Babineau?
Yes.
Okay, sure.
Go ahead.
Are those trailers there now?
Yes.
The one in the picture she showed us?
Yes.
He wants to put more.
Anybody living there?
Yeah. Yes. And I'm sorry. So it has been said maybe that we're just against trailers or against poor people. We're not. I had two mobile homes. My sons lived on my property, okay? You have evidence of what that tornado or twister or whatever. My other point is that let's just say, for argument's sake, because of the pics you see, these people are not going to be financially sound or able should a disaster like this happen to them. Why would we allow or promote these things to be settled there? I just don't understand. And I reiterated, and I have some other pictures if you want to see. Hurricane Rita, we had 3.5 feet of water in our home. And Hurricane Ike, we had another 2.5, almost 3, and that required our home to be elevated. And I've also stated that between my flood insurance for Hurricane Ike and FEMA's and the hazard mitigation programs combined, we have spent about $310,000. I can tell you my home is not, I have a decent home, but it's not a $300,000 home. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ballard. Anyone else?
Natalie Broussard, councilperson-elect for District 6. I come before you tonight to talk about Summary 308. I want to address the council, and in particular, Mr. Duncan, with all due respect. I realize that all of you were elected to serve throughout the duration of this year, and the new council does not take effect until next year. And there are certain items of business that y'all will have to complete, and you will have to rule on, and you will have to deal with between now and the end of your term. But there are other items that can wait for the new council, and this is one of them. This commission is one that the new council is going to have to be working with. The person's going to be appointed for a 5-year term. So it's going to be the new council that's going to be dealing with them for the next 4 years. So with all due respect, y'all tabled it last meeting because there were two council members not present. This meeting, there are two council members, one council member not present again, and there are several elected council members that won't have any kind of input. And those elected council members are the ones that's going to be dealing with this person. So I'm respectfully asking that y'all table this again and let us deal with it when we take office in January.
Any questions, Ms. Broussard? Mr. Ditch?
Ms. Broussard, I'll just speak to the reason why I tabled the last meeting, because one of my constituents who's applied for this position was out of the country and was not able to address this council on either time that they were able to come. He is here tonight and is able to address this council. That's the reason why I tabled the last meeting. I intend to vote on it tonight with the applicants here, and I have a couple of constituents that are here. I would be privileged to vote for either one of them, and I'd like to take that opportunity to do that, but that's the reason why I tabled it, because one of them was outside of the country and was not able to address this council.
And I respect that, and I respect whatever decision y'all make, but the commission itself has said that it's not going to be harmful to them, detrimental to them, that they can still get done what they need to be done without this appointment being made tonight. And I would respectfully request that y'all honor the wishes of the commission as well as the wishes of at least me as an elected council member coming in next year.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? State your name for the record, please.
Yes, I'm Warren Goshen. I'll be taking Troy's seat in District 5. I asked the same thing that Ms. Broussard asked, is that you guys wait and honor the new council that'll come that'll have to work with whoever it is that you would decide tonight. Politics are just about over in this parish. The shot heard around the parish went off Saturday night, and it was an eye-opener for a lot of people in this parish, but it was something that needed to be done. And I'm asking that you honor the voters of this parish by waiting and giving us the opportunity to appoint to that commission. And this is not aiming towards anyone on this board who might have been involved in the election, but this is just as a taxpayer and as a person that's coming on this board, I'd like to have the opportunity to meet each of these candidates that I'm going to work with, whoever it is that we choose to do, if you allow us or give us the opportunity. Appreciate it.
Any questions? Anyone else?
What we do with the guy who got elected already?
Say again?
What we do with the guys who got elected already? They want to work with, they want to appoint this guy. They got guys elected already. They want to work with, are they going to work with the other guys who got elected already?
Yeah.
You know, they said, let me just say something. They said it was politics last time. Mr. Brown said there were two people absent. I think it's politics this time. I mean, I don't understand it. Let's get it done.
That's right.
I felt the same way last week, Mr. Fitch. Sorry to interrupt your moment.
I don't know whether y'all should postpone or vote tonight. My name is Tom LeBlanc, and I spoke in front of you guys, I think in June, applying for when the previous seat was open. I just wanted to reiterate my interest in applying for the commission and my background. Of course, I was born and raised in New Iberia, raising three kids, going to Catholic high school. We have a service tool company, which is my dad started 45 years ago, and he's grown that. And when my brother and I joined the company, we've grown that from a regional company to a nationwide company. We import hand tools from China. We import a container every day on average. We ship out a container every day to the whole country. New Iberia is our only distribution center. Everything comes in from overseas, shipped out of New Iberia. We employ over 120 people, and our biggest deal is working with FedEx and UPS. We are their largest shipper from Louisiana. Most shipments with those companies come into Louisiana. Very few shipments go out, and that's ground. So Stella Settings would be the largest shipper air leaving Louisiana, and we are, whether we're with UPS or FedEx, the largest shipper ground leaving Louisiana. I've been, listening, learning, and understanding the importance of making a proposal to FedEx. Very interested in helping with that project to get the FedEx deal to come to New Iberia. I'm a pilot at the airport. I love to see all the improvements that y'all have been making over the years. It's been awesome. I'd like to contribute. I'd like to volunteer. I'd like to, help the community. So with that, I leave the decisions to you guys. Thank you.
Any questions for Mr. LeBlanc? Thank you. Can you state your name for the record, please?
My name is Jared Landry. I'm also applying for the seat on the board. And I'd just like to tell y'all, the few that I spoke to, thank y'all for taking the time to speaking with me, and I'd appreciate any consideration from y'all tonight. In my last spiel, kind of for this board position, I might not have the resume of some of the other applicants, and honestly, if I was looking at their resumes on paper, I'd probably vote for somebody else too, besides myself. But sometimes, and we kind of go into, no disrespect to any other applicants or anything, but sometimes you just kind of gonna go on a gut feeling. I know other people had asked for y'all to table the discussion, and I know a lot of y'all are gonna do what y'all want, and you just have to do it. You have to go on your gut and how you feel and what you feel is right. And I just appreciate the time that y'all took. I appreciate y'all serving on the council for the people that are not coming back. And I would look forward to working with any of y'all, the ones that are coming back.
Any questions for Mr. Landry? Honesty is a good attribute for getting appointed, so we appreciate your honesty. Anyone else? This is your time to speak on any item on the agenda. Hearing none, moved by Mr. Brown.
Second.
Second by Mr. Davis to go back into regular session. Roll call. That motion carries. We're now in regular session. Ordinance is introduced for public hearing and adoption. Summary number 4699, introduced by Troy Como by District 5. An ordinance amending the section 21-183B of the Iberia Parish compiled ordinances to amend the makeup of the Communications District Commission to include 7 representatives as follows. 1 member of each from certified ambulance service with Iberia Parish franchise. Number 2, the Iberia Fire Department. Number 3, Iberia Parish Fire Protection District number 1. And number 4, Iberia Parish Sheriff's Office. And number 5, 3 members at large positions.
Moved
by Mr. Broussard, second by Ms. Daniels. Discussion. I just have one question. The members at large are chosen, appointed by this board, or are they going to be appointed by the district?
By you, sir.
So to be clear, thank you. Some boards choose their own members at large. It'll be appointed by this body. Any other comments or questions? Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 4700, introduced by Ricky J. Gonsalant, District 8. An ordinance authorizing the installation of a no dumping sign on Sugar Mill Road located in District 8. Moved by Mr. Gonsalant.
Moved.
Second by Mr. Glenn Romero. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Summary number 4701, introduced by Troy Como, District 5. An ordinance amending Chapter 16 of the Iberia Parish compiled ordinances to install signs prohibiting trucks with more than 3 axles on L. Dubois and N. Dubois roads located in District 13.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Trahan, second by Mr. Wayne Romero. Discussion. Roll call. That motion carries. Resolutions introduced for public hearing and adoption at tonight's meeting. Summary number 308, introduced by Lloyd Brown, District 4. A resolution appointing 1 member to the Iberia Parish Airport Authority for a 5-year term to fill a vacancy created by the expiration of term for Ms. Wendy Carr Eldridge, whose term expires on October 28, 2015. Applications of interest on file from A. Jared Landry, B. Carl Vincent, C. Gerald Falk, D. Thomas LeBlanc Jr., and E. David Lamb.
Moved.
Moved by Mr. Brown. Second by Mr. Davis. Yes. Okay.
Yeah. I want to make a substitute motion that we table until Tommy gets here.
We have a motion to table.
And I'm a second.
Moved by Mr. Trahan to table, second by Mr. Gonsalant. Roll call. That motion fails. Just to be correct in the procedure, we wouldn't be accepting a motion. We're going to have to vote by ballot.
No way. Oh, on that.
Yeah. So I accepted the motion by Mr. Brown, but it's actually not.
Recommendation.
Okay.
And in other words, we name one.
Right. Since there are multiple applicants and no recommendation.
You got mine.
District 1, Vincent.
Brown.
District 2, Vincent.
Brown.
District 3 is absent. District 4, Vincent. District 5, Landry. District 6, Vincent. District 7, LeBlanc. District 8, Landry. District 9, Vincent. District 10, Vincent. District 11, Vincent. District 12, Vincent. District 13, LeBlanc. District 14, LeBlanc. Mr. Landry has 2, Mr. Vincent has 8, Mr. LeBlanc has 3. Mr. Falk and Mr. Lamb receive no votes. Mr. Vincent has the votes needed, he will be appointed to the seat.
Been coming to council meetings since 2000. The last 4 years, pretty regularly. And I'll tell you, some of you guys have been absolutely phenomenal for the parish. Worked with you guys, some for the whole 15 years. And I think those that voted for me know two things. I'll do the right thing for the parish, and I'll work hard. And even the ones that don't like me, kind of have to admit that. Thank you very much, and I'll do a good job. Thank you.
Summary number 329, introduced by legal counsel, a resolution granting preliminary and final approval to the Rhinella Estates subdivision, Phase 2, located in District 13. This item was denied by the planning commission.
Let them make a subdivision.
Motion for discussion.
A motion to deny?
We have a motion for discussion.
Andy.
Hold on, I need a second. Second by Ms. Daniels for discussion. Moved by Mr. Trahan, second by Ms. Daniels. Mr. Trahan, you have the floor.
Yes. Andy, do you have any legal on this?
Yes. I was concerned about this action and had asked that it be placed on the agenda a while back. In the meantime, the planning and zoning was going to meet again, it got tabled, and to see what they were going to do. I'm concerned about the fact that we've mixed planning and zoning. This property, to my knowledge, is zoned for agriculture, which allows residential developments, including mobile homes, to be constructed on it. And I think the denial, at least the initial denial, was based upon the fact that there was concern about flood issues and the fact that it was mobile homes. And the planning and zoning commission did vote again, and they once again denied it. This time, the reason was that it would devalue Rhinella Park, located near there. And based upon some of the comments made, that, again, mobile homes and flood issues. Well, I think what you have to look at is, number one, what can be constructed or done in an area that's already zoned? If you don't want mobile homes, you don't want residential, you rezone. Rezone it to a different classification. If this council doesn't want mobile homes, then prohibit them, or either require that they meet certain standards, certain building classifications, or perhaps those that are not more than 5 years old, or what, you know, whatever you think. I'm not getting into that, but if it's mobile homes that are a real issue, then there's another way to deal with it. On the other hand, if it's flooding, we got FEMA regulations. And so if this subdivision is constructed, anyone who buys a lot and anyone who wants to build a home or place a mobile home there are going to have to do it in accordance with those FEMA regulations. They may have to put it up 20 feet high in there. I don't know that, but you know, there are regulations to deal with that. So it really struck me that that this matter need to be decided one way or the other. It's lingered around for quite a while, and I think that on more than one occasion there has been a discussion among the council about, if we're going to have development, we need to move on with it. And so I thought this was an issue that needed to be addressed one way or the other. I have no recommendation whether you all approve it or not, but my recommendation is this. If it's zoned that way, and those kind of things can be constructed there, what is your reasoning for denying it? I think is what, you know, really has to. And Mr. Raines, I was not at the meeting, so I don't know what the commission articulated as its reason why it denied it, other than I think the devaluation of the park that's already there, which really begs the question of, you already have mobile homes in the area, so a mobile home is really the devaluing issue. You know, unfortunately, there's a lot of places in Iberia Parish that's subject to flooding. And that's why you have the FEMA maps. That's why you have the overlays as to what has to, as to what levels you have to build things in certain areas of the parish. So I just thought that because this was another development issue, and because developers need to know, that somebody needs to make a decision as to whether or not this development ought to be approved or not approved. And we need to, again, keep these things moving as quickly as possible. So those were my thoughts on it. Mr. Raines may have more information about what went into the thought processes of the commission or the commission members that could shed additional light on it beyond what I might know from my reading of the minutes and the action that was taken by the Planning and Zoning Commission. And I certainly would yield to him to provide the council with any additional information that he might have that perhaps I didn't provide or didn't adequately provide.
Mr. Ditch?
Yeah, this issue's come to us before, and these people has been to Planning and Zoning a couple of times, denied twice. And since I've been up here, we've denied many of these issues due to a livability issue being next door. We've denied a commercial plat like that in the middle off of Freetown Road because people didn't want to see the lights when they walked out of the back of their house. And I think, yeah, I agree, there probably needs to be some more clarification on how we do these things. But I can tell you we've denied it things and developments for a lot less. And these people have come and pled again and going to the Planning and Zoning Commission twice, and they've denied it twice. And I think it's just incumbent upon us to follow what the Planning and Zoning Commission said and deny us the development.
I agree.
I'd like to speak to that, Mr. Ditch. I just want to explain the difference. I was in the item that you just referred to, that was a zoning change. This is not a zoning change. This the way this property is zoned right now, if I understand correctly, mobile homes are permitted in the zoning.
This is zoned agricultural, correct?
Correct.
Which and is the same thing that was zoned whenever we had the issue on Sugar Mill Road and everybody went nuts over when it got moved into a trailer, got moved into an agricultural field. My only thing is, if this was next to Lucerne Drive, we could get denied in a second. And I think that's just my only.
We've had this issue come up multiple times. Yes. Since I sat up here. I filed planning and zoning.
I just want to be.
No, I agree with you. I agree with you. It was a different issue.
Right.
But I was just talking to the minor inconvenience of the lighting.
Yes.
In that said instance.
Correct. There are some similarities.
I appreciate it.
But this is not a zoning request. This is a subdivision request. And I think that's what Mr. Shealy was leading to, with planning can be so different from zoning, even though they work hand in hand. This is not a zoning request. Your turn, Mr. Raines.
Okay, what I want to hand out, in case you don't know, this is the actual layout of the proposed subdivision. I got enough to pass around all the way. And if the small print on the handout class is too bad or too small, I can show you it here. This, the area in the red oblong is the siting question. That's at the corner of McAnally Road and David Dubon, which is right off of Avery Island Road. The park is right here, and then you have the purple is industrial land, is industrial zoning, the green is agricultural, and then you have industrial here and mixed residential to the north. That's that grayish kind of color. That is all mixed residential, which allows mobile homes. It also allows a stick-built house. It also allows a modular house. It allows any kind of housing whatsoever. Agricultural does the same thing if you divide it into lots, which is what you have before you, which, if you can't read the small print, it is basically that layout. There's five lots. This is David Dubon along this side, and Ranella Park is down here. Now, when it originally went before the Planning Commission, the concern was about the ability of the area, as Mr. Moore indicated. There was a request that mobile homes not be allowed. They are allowed. They are, in the terms of a technical term, in technical terms, they are as of right. You have no right, neither you nor the commission, to deny them if they meet the standard for the mobile homes, the required setbacks, the foundations, the footings, the connections, and FEMA regulations. So they are permitted. If this tract was not proposed for development and came in as just one piece of property, they would get one mobile home. Conversely, and I hate to say this because it happens, if it came in as a family partition and was given to members of the family, five individual members of a family, they could have gotten five mobile homes. And it wouldn't have had to come before this commission or before the Planning Commission.
That needs to be tweaked.
I'm sorry?
That needs to be tweaked.
And that exists today, and that is a legal function that exists, and that is something that we agree that needs to be addressed and tweaked, as you say, because it is a big loophole. But had it come in as a family partition, you'd have five mobile homes there, no questions asked. Now, the second thing that was submitted was the flooding issue. That, once again, is out of your control and the Planning Commission's control. And that is basically a rough generation of where the flood zones are. A portion of it is in B zones, and a portion is in A zones. And that is controlled by FEMA, not by the Planning Commission, nor by the council. So when the complaints came from the area residents, they were opposing the existence of mobile homes, and there are mobile homes in the first phase, which is along this area right here, and there are mobile homes throughout the area to the north, and also scattered mobile homes along David Dubois Road, as well as stick-built houses and modular homes.
If I could, Mr. Raines, before you go too far, you just made two interesting points. We have no jurisdiction over the flood issues and the fact that trailers are allowed because it's already in that zoning. Why was it allowed to be denied because of that? I have the floor, Mr. Bitch. I'll get you next. Hang on. Why was it denied on those two reasons when you speak today that that's not an option?
I regret to say it that probably at that point in time there was such a flurry of opposition that it just skipped my mind that those were not legitimate reasons. And then when it got to preparing the ordinance for preparing the recap to the council, I said, well, this isn't right. Those are not legitimate reasons. They're out of the control of the Planning Commission. Hence, the reason it went back to the commission, and I very specifically indicated to them, and I firmly believe and will resolve The commission has the right to deny development, as does the council, for the right reasons. To simply deny it because you're concerned about flooding, which is regulated by FEMA, is not a valid reason. To deny it because you don't want mobile homes when it's permitted by right, that is not a valid reason. If there was some other reason that the developer didn't choose to comply with or wanted to have a waiver and you denied it saying, no, we're not gonna give you that, no, you have to do it, then you have every right to deny it. But that's why I went back.
All right, I have another question right in this, in line of this conversation. Are there applications for mobile homes to be put on this lot, on these lots, in this package?
No.
So what came before the planning and zoning was just acknowledge these property lines that were subdividing?
To be sold and or developed.
So, and so there's no mobile home conversation at this point?
There's no conversation on any building permit at this point.
So it's just the subdividing the property. That's what is before us tonight.
If you technically read the state law says you cannot offer for sale lots to be subdivided until you have planning commission and council approval. That's a technical reading of the law. So what the developer is doing is, I'm lining up all my ducks and getting everything in place so that when I do put up the sign saying lots for sale, everything is ready to roll.
Okay. But at this point, there was nothing in front of the Planning and Zoning Commission.
I have no application whatsoever to trailers. For anything other than to have it approved for subsequent potential sale and or development and issuance of building permits.
All right, thank you. Go ahead.
Okay, well then when we went back the second time, I told the commission that the concern about the FEMA requirements was an invalid excuse and they couldn't use that. And I told them also that the concern about the mobile homes, because they are permitted as of right, was an invalid excuse and they couldn't use that. And I said, so you have to come up, if you really want to deny it, you have to come up with another excuse. And I explained that there are other mobile homes in the area, the same story I just gave to the council. And the concern was that this is Ranella Park and the parish has put money into the park and we have to protect the value of the park. And I advised the commissioner that I thought that was a very weak rationale, because the value of the park is not gonna be affected by whether you have mobile homes or stick-built houses or apartments or whatever. Anything that would affect the value of community property would be an asset to the park. Do you have swing sets? Do you have a jogging path? Did you put up baseball, a diamond or something? But just to say that the surrounding environment was gonna impact the park, I didn't see that as valid. Unfortunately, they didn't concur with my assessment of the valuation issue. And then their second concern was that it would have a detrimental effect on the impact of other houses and developments in the area. So those were the two reasons that were given to the commission. I expressed, I won't say opposition, but reluctance to accept, saying I think those are very weak responses and very weak rationale. But to move this forward, we'll move forward.
Mr. Ditch?
Yeah, so let me just make sure what you said earlier is correct. So if the planning commission is presented with a group of people that don't feel that subdividing a piece of agricultural property in the middle of their neighborhood is appropriate, and allowing it to not be subdivided would be allowable to one unit, unless it's a family, they could put more, is what you said.
Family partition.
Correct. So if a group of people, the surrounding neighborhood, coming to the Planning and Zoning Commission with that reason, that they don't feel that agricultural land should be subdivided, it's within our jurisdiction and planning jurisdiction's right to deny it based just solely on that, correct? I understand we can't deny it for flooding and we can't deny it for the other issues, but we can deny this for that reason alone?
I would say no. The Planning Commission and the zoning ordinance are, you're exercising the police power of the community. And you do that through planning regulations and zoning regulations. They are designed by state law and by federal law to preserve, protect, and promote the health, safety, and welfare of the community. If you're going to deny development, which I certainly believe you and the commission has the right to do, you have to show why the health, safety, and welfare of the community is not being preserved, promoted, and protected.
And neighbors being there and stating that is not enough.
I would argue against it unless there was some compelling reason that you were overtaxing the transportation network, if you were overtaxing the community sewer system, if you were overtaxing the water supply.
Increasing crime?
That's a law enforcement issue as opposed to a planning issue.
But we do have the right to deny this, legally.
With the right rationale from my standpoint, respectfully.
I would agree with everything Mr. Raines has said. I would also point out, Mr. Raines didn't vote on this, planning and zoning.
Oh, no, no, I'm not insinuating.
I want to make it clear, because it kind of sounded like, no offense, it kind of sounded like, Mr. Raines, why'd you let this happen? I know that's not what you meant, but I think the important thing that you have to keep in mind is this. I'm going to give you some examples, Mr. Ditch. If this plat did not meet the platting specifications of the ordinance, for instance, you have 10-foot setbacks or 50-foot setbacks, and this plat used 25-foot setbacks. That's a perfectly legitimate reason to deny this subdivision, this plat of this subdivision, and ask that it be redrawn to do that. If it created an entrance to a highway and that entrance was dangerous or not in accordance with both parish ordinance and state law, that would be a reason to do so. But you go back and you have them redraw it and to do that. But when you have zoning that says you can do these things within this area that's zoned that way, and you want to deny somebody the right to do it, you better have not only a good reason, but a pretty compelling reason as to why you're denying that. And Mr. Ditch, the difference between this and the situation you initially gave was, again, if you're asking to rezone something, that's a whole different criteria than if you're asking whether or not something that is already zoned can be developed within that type of zoning definition, and the homes are within that zoning definition.
But within agricultural, we cannot develop this, correct?
Yes.
We can only put one, right?
No.
No.
In agricultural, you can have one mobile home per lot. If you get it approved through the plat that I showed to you, you have created five lots. That gets you five homes.
So anywhere that's agriculture, if somebody brings me this with 100 lots, they can put a trailer park right there?
No, because a trailer park is anything more than four mobile homes in one section. And then I would force that before the planning commission.
Or this could potentially be seven, right?
Those are individual lots.
It's more than four, it's five.
It's individual lots. It's
individual
a subdivision.
Lots.
It's not
a mobile
a trailer
home park.
Park
is a lot with individual sections.
Okay. All right.
I just want to remind you that when there's no application for trailers. There is nothing before us that says we're talking about trailers.
No. I'm talking about the potential for putting what could be here after they do this.
There could be a million-dollar house. There could be a trailer. There could be
sugarcane.
It could be sugarcane. It could stay in sugarcane. What I am concerned about, not that Mr. Raines did, I know he didn't vote, but I am concerned about the comment about we have to find another excuse if we want to deny it. That bothers me to my core, that we would be looking for excuses to shun development, however we like it or not, that we'd be shunning development when we're out here spending tens of thousands of dollars to recruit people to come to our parish, but we're going to find an excuse to deny bothers me at my very core.
Mr. Cuomo, I agree and I understand that. And believe me, if you stand up here enough, you're going to say some misstatements. I think what Mr. Raines really meant was that
better reason.
That you must have a compelling reason for denying. It's not that we don't want to develop it and not that we want to find an excuse, but a compelling reason why one would be denied. And sometimes we don't always choose the best words.
Sure.
So I guess I just want to make clear that, as you want, that we're not trying to say we don't want development. We're looking for excuses to prohibit development. I think what we really were trying to say is that if you have an area that's already zoned that way and somebody wants to come in and develop it, you better have a compelling reason why that's denied. Those compelling reasons need to be relating to the way it's being developed, as opposed to, I just don't like what might go there. But your point's what?
This opens a wound for me, Mr. Shealy. I developed a subdivision in 1999. I spent 2 years worth of meetings in this chambers because there weren't enough council members that liked what I was proposing. I met every bit of the ordinance, every bit of the criteria, and I was still being denied. So this opens a wound for me, and I know what the developers go through. So for us to sit here and deny someone because we don't like it when they've met all the criteria, I have a problem with that.
Well,
and I'm going to speak to that.
We didn't deny anything yet.
No, this is the comments Mr. Raines made. I'm speaking to that.
Yeah, okay. And please understand that as far as I'm concerned, and I'll say this up front, I support and endorse and defend the commission and the council's right to deny with a legitimate reason. By the same token, you very seldom hear me come before the council saying this thing's got to be stopped. It's there. It meets the regulations. There is no rationale that it cannot be protected by either my office and the issuance of a building permit or the FEMA regulations. There's nothing that gives me. I told Mr. Moore, you're going to have to go through the drainage impact analysis. You've got to provide that. We're going to have to get approval from the Board of Health. You got to do that. Any one of those things goes wrong, this whole thing stops.
Exactly.
So it's not an issue for our office, other than we are the servant to the Planning Commission, and that's what they decided. So I have to relay that to the council.
I was accused of promoting a hog farm, and we have 150 houses in there now that are worth over $120,000 to $200,000 a piece. But I was developing a hog farm. So this is an old wound for me.
Yes,
sir. Mr. Brown?
Yeah, Mr. Ray.
Yes, sir.
I see lot 8 and 9. Is there any more lots that would fall in this particular zoning that we're talking about now?
No, the area that's in the red oblong is the area in question. Those are the 5 lots. There is a continuation of phase one, which runs on up to the next corner, almost to the next corner. There's a series of lots right through here.
So
that was the previous phase.
Right. So what I'm asking you, that is zoned for trailers also.
It's zoned agricultural.
But a trailer can be put on that.
Correct.
All right. That's all. I don't need to know. That's all.
Okay. Mr. Fitch?
Mr. Raines, would it be wise for the Planning and Zoning Board to go back and look at A1 and maybe tweak it and prohibit any type of housing, used for agricultural purposes only? If you want to put up a building, it'd have to be a barn or a tractor shed or whatever. Would that be something that would...
The existing ordinance provides for housing for laborers and seasonal workers. And we have a lot of farmers. We have farmers that come in, they bring trailers in and have put up basically 2 or 3 trailers in a row that they maintain for their workers who come and stay for the season. Then they're gone, then they come back. If you were to do that, I think you would get a repercussion from the farmers who would prefer to have their workers on the property as opposed to a remote area. But if that's a suggestion of the council, we can bring that forth. It's just that it makes sense that when you have large scale farms, to have a facility for the seasonal worker.
Thank you.
Mr. Trahan?
Is there a way the developer and the landowners nearby can come to an agreement to put some stipulations that's the way it's kept up?
The maintenance?
The maintenance of the property in a certain look to have there.
That is not something that I can enforce, and one of the questions or one of the comments that's been made repeatedly is that trailers are not maintained as well as stick-built houses. And I have responded that I have seen trailers that are much better maintained than stick-built houses of three times the value, if you would. It is not something that I can control the aesthetics of the curbside appeal.
Okay. David, would your developer be willing to sit at the table and come up with something to add some stipulations on the...
I don't know that I can really speak for him for that issue. The only thing I would say there is that once he sells those lots, then he has no control over anything that the owner at that point would do or not do. And so I don't know that would really be a valid thing. He could put some stipulations, some restrictions on there. But again, it wouldn't really be him that would have to enforce that. It wouldn't be anybody other than the landowners themselves that would have to enforce that. So the restrictions that he may put together to do this are only as good as what the landowners choose to enforce. For instance, there are some subdivisions, like say Shadows Bend, that requires that does not allow a mobile home in the subdivision. If someone came and did that, there's nothing that the Planning and Zoning Commission could do strictly for that. It would be up to the landowners within that subdivision to stop that. Or in Troy's neighborhood over there, if someone put in something that was against his restrictions, it's strictly up to the landowners that are there to stop that. So yeah, that's probably not a bad idea to do that, to put some restrictions on it, but it's in the long run, it's really up to the landowners of those five lots as to whether they want to abide by that or not.
Andy? You'd have to be very careful that the restrictions that you want to put on that lot are not designed to defeat the development. It's time that you either decided you're going to allow developments that meet the specifications, or you're not. I mean, it's just time to man up, I guess. And I hate to put it that way, but that's
hang on.
Which is why I asked it to be placed on the agenda was.
Hang on, Mr. Broussard.
I think that what needs to be looked at are restrictive covenants. It's something a property owner puts on themselves that the community that buys within that subdivision have to live by. They can only litigate one another. Someone from out of town or down the street can't sue if you don't follow it. It's a restrictive covenant. We occasionally would say there is a restriction on a lot where we're allowing something to happen outside of the zoning that's there, as in we allowed a woodworking shop to be built on a piece of property. It was outside of the zoning. It was a very narrow allowance.
Special use.
Special use condition that we granted. All we said was, you can do this. You can only do this. It can only be this size. As soon as you sell a lead, it goes away. If you use it for any other use, because he was making furniture and it was also a hobby, you could not do that. So to what Mr. Sheely's saying, Morty, they can impose it upon themselves, but when we're imposing it, I classify that as spot zoning. We're basically doing things to obstruct you from using your property, which just opens up a whole nother can of worms as to you really spot zoning a piece of property.
Well, I started to say that too, yeah. But it still goes back to we're not having a zoning discussion.
Correct.
We're supposed to be having a subdivision discussion.
Correct.
As much as that overlaps, we have
it's
to make
sure
it is two completely different things, unfortunately.
We're talking about the dirt,
And the lot lines.
And not the personalities.
The lot lines.
And whether the dirt adheres to what we're calling the subdivision, to what Mr. Shealy says, we have subdivision codes. If they had a road that went there and it was more than 2,000 feet and there was no cul-de-sac, doesn't comply. If you don't have the proper setbacks, doesn't comply. This has been stamped, an engineer drew it. I think it's within the subdivision regulations.
Correct.
There's a big difference in it.
Mr. Raines?
Just offer one other thing concerning restrictions, which is a subdivision matter, not a zoning issue. And this happens fairly often. People will call my office and say there's a house under construction next door and it's made out of wood. And they'll say the subdivision covenants say the house has to be brick. If the house is made out of wood and meets the building code, we're going to permit it because I am not a party to the restriction. And I tell the people who complain, if y'all want to go get an injunction, do whatever you do, y'all got to do that. But if it meets the building code and the zoning regulations, be it wood or be it hardy board, we're going to give it a permit. So that I'm concurring with the assessment.
Ms. Babineaux, we're not in public session, but I'll give you just a moment. If you promise to be brief.
Right now.
I'll recognize you right now.
Okay. I would like to ask Mr. Shealy if he has seen this phase one of Rhinella Estates. And Mr. Rain said that in the surrounding area where, you know, they had similar mobile homes or whatever. He's talking about, if you guys are any way familiar, it's like, and I hate to say this, but it's like it's near ghetto mobile homes, and it's like any type of flooding or bad weather. I can't imagine this. I also need to ask him, or ask Mr. Shealy, if, do you concur with Mr. Raines that at the implementation of the ordinances, the zoning ordinances in 2009, that they don't have to be granted? That they can be grandfathered in, being the 2006 initiation of the subdivision had no zoning at all. And I would also ask Mr. Raines if he's taking his professional stand on this, why at the last permit meeting did he help us or the members to devise a valid reason for denial?
Ms. Babineaux, I'm just going to interject real quick. Keep in mind, there's nothing before us about mobile homes tonight.
Right.
I know it's an emotional, and I know it affects you forever, and I apologize for that. But before what's before us, we see the pictures because you brought them, but what is before us is the property lines tonight.
Phase two?
Phase two.
It's going to be bigger and better.
We have no jurisdiction over that. We do not have any jurisdiction. That's the point I'm trying to make. Before us tonight are the property lines, not the permits for mobile homes, not the permits for houses, or continued agriculture.
What is the point of having a permit committee if it has to meet with certain?
It is part of the process. They have one part of the process. We have the second part of the process. We've overturned many. We've agreed with many. It is part of the process that we have two phases of review. I'll yield to Mr. Shealy. If you care to answer, fine. If not,
I'll try. There were multiple questions there. First of all, what is on phase one makes no difference as to phase two. My only concern, my suggestion to the council is, you need to determine whether or not phase two meets the legal requirements for a subdivision, and is that area in which residential housing is allowed. And I think Mr. Raines has answered both of them. I think what Mr. Raines did was told the folks that were there that you must have a compelling reason. And in some instances, these may be compelling reasons, but they need to be compelling reasons. They need to apply here. Secondly, you ask, what is the purpose for this commission? Well, that zoning commission is to, number one, study whether or not certain property within the parish should be rezoned for another use. whether it should be rezoned for commercial use or residential use or what use, and this council certainly has the right to redraft, review, change the ordinances that exist to change your development requirements. And I think at this point in time, it's chosen not to do that, and there may be something that needs to be looked at, but we have to deal with what we have in the way of ordinances now, and this, unless Mr. Raines feels otherwise, it appears to me that this particular plat meets the requirements for a subdivision plat. And this particular subdivision is located within a zoning area that would allow homes to be placed on there. And that should be the end of the discussion, unless there is, again, reasons why this plat doesn't comply with the statute or ordinance, or reasons why, again, because of the length of the road or other things that it needs to be changed. And nobody's presented any reason why this subdivision, as it's platted, does not comply with the ordinance.
And if, well, I'm not going to put you on the spot. That's Mr. Moore, I promised I would recognize you at this time.
Yeah, just one other clarification I'd like to make, too, is that the commission that voted for this was the Planning Commission. There's actually a separate zoning commission that deals with zoning. In our case, for Iberia Parish, those two, it's the same people on both commissions, but it's two separate actions, and it's two separate meetings that actually occur at that time. And so this item was strictly before the Planning Commission because there was no rezoning that needed or was going to be required. And so there was nothing coming from the Zoning Commission. This strictly came from the Planning Commission.
Call for the question.
Does anyone else have any comment? I'm sorry, Ms. Babineau, we need to wrap this up. Anyone else? I'm not going to entertain the question. We're ready to vote.
You have a resolution?
Yes, absolutely. I agree.
Which one did you accept?
A resolution granting preliminary and final approval to the Rhinella Estates subdivision phase 2 located in District 13. So a vote yes grants the approval. A vote no denies the approval. Would you agree, Mr. Shealy? As it per the agenda? A resolution granting. So a vote yes grants. A vote no denies.
Yeah, vote yes overrides the decision. Yes.
A vote yes approves. A vote no denies. Roll call. That motion carries to grant. That motion carries. The preliminary and final approval is granted. Summary number 330. Introduced by Maggie F. Daniels, District 1. A resolution of condolences to the family of Miss Lena Lewis James, mother of Iberia Parish worker, Water Works, District Number 4, Commission Member Jennifer Olivier, who passed away on October 8, 2015. Moved by Ms. Daniels.
Second.
Unanimous. Call for a unanimous second. Roll call. That motion carries. Let the record reflect. So, several council members have left their seat.
Yep.
Summary number 331, introduced by the clerk of the council, a resolution declaring a Xerox Work Center 6505 printer, a General Electric television, and a Dell laptop computer from the legislative branch as surplus, and further authorizing disposal of same in accordance with the parish policy and state law as requested by the legislative department.
Moved
by Mr. Glenn Romero, second by Mr. Davis. Discussion, roll call. That motion carries. Excuse me. Okay. Summary number 332. introduced by the Clerk of the Council, a resolution giving preliminary approval to the Parish of Iberia, State of Louisiana, to incur debt and borrow an amount for operations not exceeding $2 million, making application to the Louisiana State Bond Commission for approval thereof, employing professionals with respect to the borrowing, and taking other matters in connection therewith, offered by the Hospital Service District Number One.
Move.
Moved by Mr. Broussard, second by Mr. Brown. Discussion. Mr. Akers?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, Jason Akers at Foley and Udell. Mr. Templeton and Ms. Kirk from the hospital were not able to be here tonight, but they did ask me to just briefly explain the reason for this, because this is not something that this council typically does as a revenue anticipation note. Beginning about 6 weeks ago, and I'm going to give you my very elementary understanding of this, hospital billing codes changed from what was known as ICD-9 to ICD-10 in the United States. And while the hospital has been preparing for this and the medical center is up to date and ready to go, the fear is that because of this change in billing codes, which goes from codes numbering a possibility of 14,000 codes to almost 70,000 different medical codes for different procedures, that CMS, which runs Medicaid and Medicare reimbursement, will not be ready for the reimbursement to proceed as rapidly as it normally does. And in this context, rapid is a very unique term to use. They have asked for a revenue anticipation note, which will be a very short term, mature in less than 12 months, will only be drawn if absolutely necessary to survive this delay in reimbursements that may occur. Both Mr. Templeton and Ms. Kirk will be here on November 24th when you address the ordinance dealing both with the ordinance that's being introduced today, and there will be another ordinance introduced on November 10th selling these revenue anticipation notes. They'll be here to address any questions you might have about either one of them then. But they did ask me to give you a brief explanation of the reason for this request. It is purely belts to go along with the suspenders that they're already wearing.
Any questions for Mr. Akers?
I'll leave it to stand.
That's an expensive belt.
Yeah, I think he thought we might have pulled it off the table.
Yeah, he wouldn't go over
there. Yeah,
any questions for Mr. Akers?
I'm not going to withdraw now that you said that.
Roll call.
We don't want your pants to fall.
That motion carries.
Now you're going.
I saw that.
That was nice.
False alarm. Get a motion to adjourn.
Yeah, thank you.
Meeting is adjourned.